Who created the Turok franchise? And how did it all start? While it has spawned many video games over different platforms, each story also introduces a new person that takes up the mantle of Turok. A couple of years ago, I did cover some lore around the most successful Turok in history, Tal Set. So now, I want to talk about the origins of Turok, and some lore around the Campaigner, Primogen, and Oblivion. This is going to be a very extensive video that goes deep into the lore of Turok. There's a lot to cover, so let's get started. The year was 1954. Turok, Son of Stone, was featured in issue number 596 of Four Color Comics. While the expanded lore says that Turok was a title given to a chosen warrior, the early days of this story show that Turok is the name of a man. Turok and his brother Andar are seen hunting for food in the Carlsbad area of the desert, but they come across an open cavern with bats flying outward. Because their water supply had run out, Turok decides to venture within. By using greasewood stems, they light torches and make their way inside. They would find a pool of water as Andar reaches out to quench his thirst. Turok stops him, saying that it's poisonous, as shown by a pile of bones with no visible wounds from animals. As the two of them explore this cavern of darkness, they locate some drinkable water, but they also encounter a new species of fish with no eyes. They were drawn to the heat of the fire. Going further into the cave, a large bear finds them. They quickly jump deep underwater. The fish tend to stick near the surface and attack the bear that followed Turok and Andar. With no other option, Andar and Turok venture forward. With light in the distance, they come across an opening, and with their eyes, they gaze upon a different world below the desert, a world they may never be able to leave. This enormous cavern had its roof collapse many ages ago. Its moist temperature and warm springs have preserved much prehistoric life. Life that has long been extinct everywhere else in the world. Alongside dinosaurs, a tribe of Stone Age Indians is still alive in this lost capsule of time. They are hostile towards Turok and Andar, but eventually they become more friendly when they are offered food. This story also states that Turok and Andar are both from the Mandan tribe. Both of them would teach these people how to hunt with bows and arrows. The story would end there for now. About a year later, Turok was brought back in issue number 656. This was its second and last chance to build a large audience. This would mark the continuation or the end of the Turok franchise. It was all down to this. The story continues with Turok along with Andar teaching these people how to use the bow and arrow for hunting. But one tribe member seems to want Turok's own bow for himself, considering how well built it is. During this second story, we see that the Stone Age Indian tribe is now speaking in English rather than in their native language, perhaps to give us a better understanding of what's being said. Sinnok, the one who went against Turok, is said to be punished. He is given sentry duty above the canyon. Armed with only a club, Sinnok waits and thinks. As darkness falls upon the land, a man is heard screaming. The sound pierces the night sky and is heard by the people. Only Turok and Andar go up to check, but Sinnok is gone. No trace of him is left behind, only his club remains. The two of them decide to wait. Perhaps they can find a clue of what happened, but with no claw marks, no injuries, no fur, they can't figure out what happened. The next night, a single sentry is placed and he too is taken. And so, Turok and Andar take the next shift. But it's not long until they encounter something new. A shadow flies in the sky, heading towards both of them. As it gets closer, they shoot their poison-tipped arrows at it. Andar and Turok dodge its attack, and the Pteranodon falls. It is defeated. After surviving the encounter, they come across a cave where the creature flew out of. As they explore within, they encounter more. It's most likely their breeding place. After some time, they find an exit and find themselves in a second valley. They come across more animals and other sources of food like fruit. When a large buffalo attacks them, they use their poison arrows to defeat it. But they are met up with a lone woman searching for the missing group of hunters. They offer her meat and she accepts. The three of them carry more food back to her tribe to feed her starving people who have not eaten for 2 moons. Over time, Turok would be part of the new tribe and help them hunt for food. With the help of the woman, Yelena, he teaches her about his poison medicine. The three of them would eventually locate the missing hunters from the tribe. They were chased into a pit by some great beasts, but they survived when other animals fell within, which supplied them with food for weeks. By using some rope, Turok is able to get everyone out of the pit. With a joyful reunion at the village, the story of the second issue ends here. After this story was published, the Turok fanbase had increased, and so Turok was given his own series in 1956. It spanned over 130 issues until 1982. Then, in 1993, Valiant Comics would revive the Turok franchise with their own list of comic books. A total of 48 issues were released until 1996. During the same year in 1996, Acclaim would acquire the license to the Turok franchise and create their own line of comic books. This was mainly to build more interest for their future plans. This led to the release of the video game Turok Dinosaur Hunter on the Nintendo 64 console. With new 3D models, huge worlds to explore, various enemy types, exploration, puzzle solving, and a big arsenal of weapons. While it was limited to being a single player game, it was not far off from being one of the best games on that console at the time. The writer for the first story of Turok in 1954 actually wrote a story 12 years earlier of something very similar. In 1942, Gaylord Dubois came up with a story for Young Hawk, all focused on Native Americans. It centered around Young Hawk and Little Buck going about their day-to-day survivals, solving problems, and making friends within other tribes. You could see it as an inspiration to Turok. This small strip could be found in the New Funnies, which was later renamed to Walter Lantz New Funnies comic series. It was dedicated to established cartoon characters, but also served as a way to introduce new characters. Young Hawk would then go on to appear in the Lone Ranger comic books. In issue number 123, released in 1958, Young Hawk is seen in the story. The Turok comic books would then continue in the hands of Dark Horse Comics from 2010. Then, it ended up in the hands of Dynamite Comics from 2013. Now that we've established the origin of Turok and its long-running comic book series, let's get into the game that was released on Nintendo 64 back in 1997. I want to go deeper into the lore of the main villains of the story, starting off with the campaigner in the first game. He was an evil tyrant cyborg, also known as the Hollow One. When he acquired knowledge of an ancient artifact known as the Chrono Scepter, this conquering warlord wanted to also conquer the multiverse. He learned that it possessed destructive power to shred the fabric of space and time. With this power in his hand, he would rule the entire multiverse. The Chrono Scepter was created thousands of years ago. The Lazarus Concordance, which are a group of elders, would shatter the Chrono Scepter into 8 pieces and spread it across the Lost Land. Such great power should never end up in the hands of evil. What we know is the Lost Land is merely a name for its true purpose. It serves as the interdimensional sewer of the universe. Anyone can be transported here through random appearing portals or tears in reality. It's inhabited by many species across the multiverse, with some being the same species, except they were separated by millions of years of evolution or genetic tampering. Tal Set would make his way through the Lost Land and finding all 8 pieces of the Chrono Scepter, and battle the campaigner in his fortress. It was a display of Tal Set's fighting spirit versus the cyborg's enhanced abilities. Knowing he must not fail, he fought with determination, courage, and every bit of his strength. The fate of all life, all of existence, would be determined in this final battle of good versus evil. In the end, Talset was victorious. The campaigner's reign of terror was over, at least in this story. The campaigner would appear in the multiplayer for Turok 2 Seeds of Evil and Turok Rage Wars. It had a small story in Rage Wars that was linked to the first game. He enters the Rage Wars to seek revenge against the Turok who foiled his plans. If he wins the tournament, the campaigner will obtain the Light Burden. But what is the Light Burden? It's basically a leather satchel worn by all Turoks. According to the lore of the Primogen, which I will cover in a bit, the Light Burden contains a small fragment of energy from the Big Bang. It acts as a conduit to an infinite arsenal of items, magical talismans, weapons, food, and currency. It is said that only a Turok can access its vast, infinite supply, but anyone not related to the Fire Seed lineage, the bag will act as a regular, empty leather satchel. Which makes you wonder, does the campaigner even know about that? The Light Burden satchel was seen in some promotional pictures. You can see Turok is wearing it, but in later pictures, it was removed. The game's loading screen and introduction has the Light Burden not appearing at all. The campaigner is also said to be a title given to the next person in line of power, so it transfers from one being to another, similar to how Turok is just a title as well. The Turok Online exclusive webcomic shows the campaigner holding the Chrono Scepter, but Turok takes it and destroys him with it. One source said that the original concept of the campaigner was in the Valiant comic books, but after going through every issue, I saw no wording of the campaigner, unless they're talking about the warlord in the story, or maybe I missed it somewhere. Now, in another comic book called Turok, Spring Break in the Lost Land, the campaigner is mentioned by that name. Joshua Fireseed is contacted by Yannick, a Turok from the future, and he explains that the actions of Talset in the past ended up creating another campaigner. This one was a former soldier of the American Civil War, a Confederate prisoner held in a POW camp. He was forced to fight just to survive, but during an encounter on Earth with Talset and Gilad, he managed to escape, and was later a logical choice to be made into a campaigner. The reason he's in this time frame now is explained by how the Lost Land acts as a hub around normal time circles. Any lifeform can reach other locations by going through the Lost Land. By now, you might be asking, why is the Lost Land acting as a hub? And I will get to that very soon in the video, but first, let's finish this topic. So Joshua's friends were captured by the campaigner, and in order to free them, Joshua challenges him to a special type of match. It's called situational batting practice. As silly as it sounds, the challenger can set the rules of combat. Joshua challenges the campaigner and wins. He frees his friends and everyone is sent home. This design of the campaigner was seen in the Game Boy Color version of Turok 3 Shadow of Oblivion. He threw fireballs and sent out bugs towards the player. In the Game Boy game, Turok, Battle of the Bionosaurs, we get to see the campaigner's design from the Nintendo 64 game. There were a few Turok novels released in 1998 and 1999. It wasn't so well known at the time, but the campaigner was mentioned in these stories. So, what happened to the Chrono Scepter after the first game? Knowing how powerful this weapon is, Talset consulted with Turoks of the past and future. He decides to destroy it by throwing it into an active volcano. But in doing so, this triggers a violent earthquake all across the Lost Land, and it awakens the Primogen from his sleep. Now we get into who this Primogen is, and how his story fits into everything. A billion years after the Big Bang formed the known universe, one of the earliest races of intelligent beings forged great lightships to discover the answers to the mysteries of their existence. One of these beings, the Primogen, was not satisfied with studying bits of shell after the hatching of the cosmic egg. He yearned to witness the dawn of time. But the Primogen's desire paled before the awe and danger of traveling across the very first event horizon. At the height of the momentous journey, the lightship's core breached. Its escaping energy made contact with the primordial elements of the cosmos and created an explosion that hurled the Primogen and his lightship into the maw of infinity. From out of the dawn of the universe, a blazing wheel of reality corkscrewed into the heart of the space-time continuum. With the Primogen and his lightship trapped at its core, this whirling reality gathered bits and pieces of our universe along the way, like a snowball going downhill. After about a millennia, the matter around the vessel had formed a planet, one separated from the space around it by the massive energy which is known as the Netherscape. This planet would later become habitable by the technology of the lightship. The planet itself became known as the Lost Land by anyone who ended up here. So the planet is basically a damaged alien ship surrounded by matter it collected as it drifted through space. The elders of the Lost Land would erect energy totems in specific places. They used the lightship's power for the Lost Land. They would keep the Primogen confined to his lightship, but if they are all destroyed, the shockwave would destroy the world, and the Primogen would be set free. By using its telepathic powers, the Primogen called upon the dinosaurs to destroy the totems. He also made deals with other races to help free him from his lightship. It's a race against time. Turok must defend all the totems. Adon is brought into the story. She is the speaker of Forever Light. She serves as a connection between the people of Galiana, which is the capital city of the Lost Land, and the Council of Voices. Since her birth, Adon was prepared to take up the position of the Speaker of Forever Light, a position she took after her mother's untimely passing. She would serve as a guide for Turok throughout his missions. The Council of Voices consists of members who act as the governing body of Galiana. Thousands of years ago, each member of the council became sick and suffered from disease. With their bodies failing them, they would instead upload their minds to a massive computer system. Their physical bodies were placed in stasis. This process would render them immortals. Their motives are kept in secret, but they are in fact tyrants in another form. In times of peril, they would give up the lives of billions of innocent beings just to ensure their own survival. While Adon yearns for another life, the council monitors her thoughts and feelings. She yearns for something different, to be free of her confines, but is denied this request. If you end up protecting all of the energy totems, you will get the good ending in the game. Their power is used to finish off the Primogen in his weakened state. The combined energy from the totems would shatter his body and destroy the last traces of the Primogen's telepathic powers. Adon will say this at the end: "The Omniverse is in your debt." However, if you do not save all the totems, you will get the bad ending. Adon will say, "I feel, however, that the Primogen is not truly gone. For now, we can only wait." She also mentions, "I was unable to identify the force which conspired against you during a battle with the Primogen. Its form eluded me. While I searched, a feeling of dread washed over me, a feeling unlike any that I have ever experienced. There is a natural balance in the cosmos between that which we define as good and that which we know as evil, light and dark, order and chaos. Although I have been unable to gain any specific knowledge of this being, its energy signature feels as if it exists beyond either fundamental force. And one other thing, Joshua, each time I scanned this entity's signature, I also detected the energies of the Turok lineage as well. Whatever it is, your ancestors have dealt with it before." In the comic book, it expands on the Primogen's social connections to his people. His lust for knowledge initiated the end of his universe. He had a home and a mate. He simply wants to go home to see them again. By using the light burden, which contains the purest form of energy and power from his universe, this time storm is used on the Primogen and he vanishes. In the end, the lightship is left intact. But when they rebuild new obelisks, its power source will continue to fuel Galiana. This ending is far different from the video game. Instead of destroying the Primogen, Joshua gave a tortured being the chance to reunite himself with all that he has lost. So what is this unknown entity? Well, throughout Turok 2, you will find these portals. They grant you ammo and health, things to help you on your journey, but some are fake portals that lead to a dark place full of flesh-eater enemies. They are cannibals, and they perform acts of evil along with secret rituals. There are various ranks within their group, and they all follow someone called Oblivion. The first cutscene is pretty long, but it delivers cryptic messages about Joshua's mission, which includes the totems, the primogen, and how Joshua is set to fail. Here's the cutscene.
Cease, human! Powers beyond the comprehension of flesh!
Have you set in motion?
The primogen must not be stopped!
The totems must fall!
The balance must falter! Chaos must commence!
We are the darkness!
We are the unseen! We are Oblivion! That which has been set in motion cannot be stopped!
Your deeds!
Your life! Your very existence falls under the great shadow of Oblivion! Your failure is inevitable!
After the credits of the bad ending in Turok 2, you can hear a voice say these words, "It is inevitable." This means the coming of Oblivion cannot be stopped. This continues in the video game Turok 3, Shadow of Oblivion. There was another comic book story all about Adon's curse. It takes place after the Primogen's defeat. The fabric of our reality was weakened during this event. Energy from the vortices are being released. By reversing it, this was the only chance of saving Galliana. But the Council is bent on saving their own existence and letting the Lost Land perish. Adon comes up with a plan. If they channeled the energy from the vortices instead, they could use it to fortify their dimensional barrier. But they would need a conduit like Adon and a sentience like the Council of Voices. The only problem here is they would all be trapped in a forever hellish stasis, never to escape. Adon was able to break free of the mental control the Council had on her. She had free will at last. Adon would sacrifice herself, knowing she would never see Joshua again. Her last wish was to save Galliana and Joshua. So who or what is Oblivion? Well, eons ago, before our universe was created, before the Lost Land even existed, there was Oblivion, a savage entity that drifted through the cosmos, devouring entire worlds it made contact with. It would invade the bodies of life forms and devour them from the inside. This being would feed off the energies of the dead and dying. Around the time the Primogen's lightship was damaged in the past, it released an energy surge so powerful that the universe was destroyed. The shockwave that followed would destroy Oblivion's original body. It barely survived, but this was the same energy within the light burden that Turok carries. This was the only source that caused any pain to Oblivion. As Oblivion was regaining its strength, it began looking for a way to open a portal through the Netherscape. This is what separates our world from the Lost Land and countless others. Oblivion seeks to end the Turok lineage, so there would be no more trace of the light burden. It would spawn a race called the Flesh Eaters, and they would serve its master. After the events of Turok 2, Joshua would have dreams of a child and the impending doom of Oblivion. He believed the child was the key to something. Oblivion would find its way to Earth and send out the Flesh Eaters to find Joshua. But during an attack within his home, Joshua sacrifices himself so Daniel and Joseph can escape. Daniel and Joseph would be taken by Adon and brought to the Council of Voices. Danielle takes up the mantle of Turok, the son of stone. Later on, Adun would come across an inscription about a child. She thinks it's the key to saving Joshua, so she ventures off to find her answers. And together, they would track down the child later in the story, but the child was not the key. It was merely a trap to lure the Fireseed family to it. Oblivion reveals itself and tries to attack the three of them, but it's quickly defeated by Adun, Joseph, and Danielle. A small piece of Oblivion survives the encounter and scurries off. It must be destroyed before it escapes. The three of them chase after it, only to find Joshua alive and waiting for them. He assures them that everything will be all right, but Adun knows this is not the real Joshua and opens fire upon him. Oblivion has taken over the body of Joshua. He is defeated again, and it exits the body of Joshua. It's then destroyed by the use of the light burden and its powers within. This marks the end of Oblivion. With his last breath, Joshua tells Danielle he was wrong about his vision. It is her child who is the key. He will be special. Protect him. And with that, Joshua passes away. During the ending of Turok 3, Adun has one request from the Council. Despite Joshua dying, she believes she can still save him. When the Council rejects her single wish, she defies them and leaves. Because the Council had a telepathic link to Adun, they were always aware of her feelings for Joshua. They knew this day would come, and so they summon Ivri, and she prepares to serve the Council of Voices. So that covers a lot of lore around the Turok franchise, starting from its very first inspiration in 1942, then going into a vast amount of comic books and a few novels, to the video games released on the Nintendo 64 console. If you enjoyed this video, I would appreciate a like rating. And do you think they should revive the Turok franchise at this time? Put your thoughts in the comment section. I know there are other Turok games not included in this video, but I chose topics that caught my interest. Thanks for watching. My name is Carlos, or Acid Glow, and I'll see you in the next video.